Jesus Christ,
now and forever.
Welcome to the Testibus Christi Domini. Today I'm here with Louis and Mark, and we will continue our series in the Gospel of Luke. We are doing a study, a Bible study of the Gospel of Luke, which we began last week. You can check out our first video in the series. We introduced the Gospel of Luke. We introduced who Luke was, a little background history about the Gospel. We covered the first few verses in the prologue of Luke. But Luke is very unique. It's a unique gospel amongst the four because we see in Mark, it begins right away with the life of the ministry of Jesus. Matthew gives a little bit of the infancy narrative of Jesus through the eyes and perspective of Saint Joseph, the foster father of Jesus. John begins right away with his long prologue and then right away into the life of Christ. But Luke does something different. He goes to a time frame just before the birth of Christ, and he introduces some very important figures that are not mentioned in the other Gospels. He mentions Zechariah, who is the father of John the Baptist, Elizabeth, the mother of John the Baptist, goes over the annunciation of the birth of Christ through Mary and the birth of Jesus, and there's very intimate details of that prior to his birth and the birth of Christ, which is very really important knowledge because it really sets the scene for the whole rest of the book of the Gospel. And we see with the passage we're going to study today, which is the announcement of the birth of John the Baptist. John the Baptist is the last prophet of the Old Testament and the first prophet of the New Testament. He is the one who makes the way ready for Jesus in the Gospels, all four Gospels. He is the one who prepares the way for Jesus. But in the other Gospels, there's not much detail about the life of John the Baptist. There is a little bit, but not like in Luke. In Luke, we see his birth foretold to Zechariah, his father. And Zechariah is a priest doing ministry in the temple. And he goes into the Holy of Holies to offer yearly incense, that only once a year to go in there and offer the incense. And an angel of the Lord appears to him and announces that he will bear a son, him and his wife, Elizabeth, who had been barren all these years. And John hears those words, doesn't believe, and the angel strikes him mute, as we'll come to read. But the events take place, just as the angel had foretold Zechariah in the temple, and Elizabeth, who had been old and barren all her life, conceives a child and bears a son, and they call him John. John the Baptist. And we see the parallel between, in the first part of the Gospel of Luke, we have the birth of John foretold, and then we have the birth of John. We have the birth of John foretold, then we have the birth of Jesus foretold. Then we have the events of the birth of John, and then we have the events of the birth of Jesus. There's a parallelism that takes place here. And you can see even John, just like all the prophets of the Old Testament, they all foreshadow the person of Jesus. He is the one they're all pointing to. All the prophets, from Adam all the way to John the Baptist, they all point to Jesus. He's the one that they're pointing. And Luke makes this evident in his gospel. So let's dive right in. You know, we introduced the gospel last week, so we can dive right into the text. And Mark, why don't you start off verse 5, chapter 1, verse 5. We're going to read all the way to verse 25 today.
In the days of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah of the division of Abiah. And he had a wife of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord blamelessly. But they had no child, because Elizabeth was barren, and both were advanced in years. Now while he was serving as the priest before God, when the division was on duty, according to the custom of the priesthood, it fell on him by lot to enter the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And the whole multitude of the people were praying outside at the hour of incense. And there appeared to him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And Zechariah was troubled when he saw him, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer is heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear a son, and you shall call his name John. And you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. For he will be a great before the Lord, and he shall drink no wine nor strong drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. And he will turn many of his sons of Israel to the Lord God, and he will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready for the Lord a people prepared. And Zechariah said to the angel, "How shall I know this? For I am an old man, and for my wife is advanced in years. And the angels answered him, "I am Gabriel, who stand in the presence of God, and I was sent to speak to you and bring you this good news. And behold, you will be silent and unable to speak until the day that these things come to pass, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their time." And the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondered at this delay in the temple. And he came out, he could not speak to them, and they perceived that he had seen a vision in the temple, and he had made signs to them and remained mute. And when this time of service was ended, he went to his home. After these days, his wife Elizabeth conceived, and for 5 months she hid herself, saying, "Thus the Lord has done to me in the days when he looked on me to take away my reproach among men." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. That's wonderful.
Powerful.
What a beautiful story. I mean, to a point, stories self-explanatory, but Word of God is breathing and alive, and there's always more to draw. Like we said last week, Luke, the gospel writer, really writes, like you said, in a unique way. You see, even here, like in the prologue, he says that he went and talked to eyewitnesses. Now he's telling us in verse 5, When this event took place. He's telling us, in the days of Herod, king of Judea. So it's interesting to talk a little bit about Herod. Who was Herod? He was made a king over Judea in 37 BC before Christ, and he was a client king of Caesar Augustus, and it says here that he's a king of Judea, but he's not the king of the Jews, because Herod was considered the most as half Jew, because his dad was Idumean, which is a south region of Judea, and his mother was some kind of Arabian princess. So the Jews didn't really like him to be their king, because Jews expected Messiah to come and be their king, and this guy was not even completely Jewish. So he was not the king in the line of David. So there was a problem there right away. And we see that he had that problem too. He waited when his kingdom will be taken away from him. So when the wise man, we will read that later on in the rest of the scriptures, but when the wise man come and tell him and foretold him the king of the Jews will be born, referring to Jesus, he freaked out. Mm-hmm. He said, "Yeah, go search him up and come and tell me you want to kill him." And when they deceived it, they didn't go back to him. They actually went and adored Jesus, the true king. They never adored Herod. Then he ordered all children under 2 years old to be killed. So before Jesus then comes back from Egypt, because Joseph took him to Egypt to save the child and his mother, before he came back, Herod died. And this is the end of what we know about Herod in the Bible. But another Herod steps in, and that's his son. So Herod had three sons. One was Archelaus, one was Philip, and one was Antipas. And this kingdom was divided between three of his sons, and one region was kept by Romans. So that's why we got tetrarchy. And Archelaus is the one who will be known the most in a future stories. and King Antipas, and Antipas is the one, Herod Antipas, who ordered the death of John the Baptist. Talking about John the Baptist, I'm giving up the story, but Antipas ordered his death. Why? Because John the Baptist told him straight to his face, it is not right for you to do what you did. And what did he do? He took his brother's wife, Philip's wife. He took her for his wife. And John the Baptist stepped up and said, this is not right. So, talking about announcement of birth of John the Baptist, we see that he was a feisty man. That he was a strong man. That he was a courageous man. And we need those kind of people today. We need our bishops to be like that. To tell the government leaders, this is not right what you're doing. To have courage and speak boldly in the name of the Lord. But we see that John the Baptist also has a pedigree. Very good pedigree. Priestly pedigree. His father, Zechariah, was a priest from the line of Aaron and Levitical priesthood. So does his wife. That's why it says his wife was from the daughters of Aaron. So name Zechariah means God remembered, and we're gonna see as we read the story that God never forgot about him. Even when Zechariah thought it's over, I'm not gonna have a son, God will remember his prayers. He will declare to him that I know your prayers and I know desires of your heart. That's what God does. Even when you think God has forgotten about me, he never forgets about you. He remembers our prayers and he answers our prayers.
Yeah. And just from like a historical perspective, again, just to establish that, you see, as far as like we discussed last week, the genre being established. In the days of Herod, again, giving a timetable of the events that are happening. You know, this is not stories, ancient stories and legends, they don't begin. Even in modern day, you know, Star Wars, you know, in a galaxy far, far away, a time long, long ago, it's happened. This is not in a place long, long ago. It tells you in a time long, long ago or in a place so and so. It says that is in a specific place in Judea, a specific time. Herod was king. Not somebody else's king. Herod was king. So this establishment of the genre, that this is history. This is a history, a theological history, and a literal history that John is giving to us. I mean, Luke is giving to us.
I think to kind of go off kind of both of you as well, it was when we went over the prologue, the last verse was that you may know the truth concerning the things of which you have been informed. And when Louis is talking about Zechariah and his name, Yahweh has remembered. You know, God has remembered. He's remembered all the things that we've been informed about. You know, this is why he remembers Zechariah. Because as we get in a little further in verse 6, they both walked in the ordinance blameless.
Yeah, so we have verse 6. It says, they were both righteous before God, walking all commandments and ordinances of the Lord blameless. So we see here that, like we said many times, it's hard enough to be righteous in front of people. How much harder is to be righteous in the face of God when all secrets are exposed and everything's transparent to God? Because I can fake being a righteous person in front of you, and you might think I'm a righteous person, but these people, God says that they're righteous. God sees them as righteous. So it's not easy to be righteous in the face of God, because God sees all things. You remember what God says to when Samuel went to anoint David, and he entered the house of David's father's house and looked at the first brother and said, this must be it. Look, good looking, he's great, he must be the king. And God says, no, for man sees the outward appearance, God sees the heart. So he sees the heart of Zechariah and Elizabeth, and he says they're righteous before God. But you can be righteous before God and still be barren, because we don't only depend on our own righteousness. We need a divine intervention, and that's exactly what happened here. Divine intervention happened for Zechariah to be completely immersed in the righteousness of God. Because on its own, he was righteous, but when the big news came, great announcement, intervention of God, he wasn't that quick to believe it. His righteousness was not enough there. So our righteousness, it's not enough to believe supernatural things of God. And that's this we're going to see that John, that Zechariah fails here actually. Because it's a supernatural announcement. And we need supernatural grace to believe this. We need supernatural grace to be able to accept what God is giving us. And his grace is great. And his grace is sufficient for us to believe it. But we need his grace. And this is going to be actually declared in here. Like, listen, your righteousness is not enough. And another point not to forget to touch upon is that the Bible actually says Zechariah is righteous. Protestants always say none is righteous because there's a biblical verse that says at the time the none was righteous. But we see there are righteous people in here. But still, we do not depend on our righteousness, but we need to be righteous in the sight of God and according and act according to his righteousness.
Mm-hmm. Amen. And that only happens with his grace. So let's continue with verse 7. But they had no child, because Elizabeth was barren, and both were advanced in years. And this verse is this barrenness. There's a link here between the barrenness of Israel. Because Israel, in a sense, is barren, especially in this time. There has been no prophet for centuries come upon Israel, and they're barren. They haven't produced the works of God. And in a sense, they've always been barren, because every time Israel has had the opportunity to step up and to serve God righteously, they fail. They fail. They constantly fail. And it's also they're also waiting. Just like how Zechariah and Elizabeth are advanced in years, they have been waiting since the time of Adam for the Messiah, for the promise of God. And yet, the promise has not yet come. They're barren in a sense. But God is about to take away the barrenness of Israel through Jesus Christ.
It's very powerful, because the last prophet we've seen was Malachi. It was, like you said, it was about 400 years difference before we heard another prophet. So when we speak about this barrenness, especially with, you know, prophets and the message of God and all these things that they're waiting for, you know, it shows this instance that a man who walked blameless in ordinances between Zechariah and Elizabeth, that God is going to bestow upon them. So that's why, as Louis is talking about, there when he talked about no righteousness, you know, that this is the message that we're going to see. Okay, if you're righteous and you walk blamelessly, God will, you know, not only just bestow upon you a great gift, but bless you and your family and those to come.
And this is a spiritual link, but it's very powerful, because, like you said, Louis and Mark, they are righteous, but it's not enough. They're still barren. And it takes, in order for Elizabeth to conceive, she needs God's grace. And this can be said in our spiritual life too, that at the end of the day, in order to be saved, we need the grace of God. We need, in order to bear fruit spiritually in our lives here and now and for eternity, we need his grace. But at the same time, it requires for us to be righteous before God, to work like our that grace, that barrenness, okay? In order to go away, it requires the grace of God. But it also requires for us to be righteous, to walk blamelessly before God. So it's like, it's a both and. Like, we need to be righteous. We need to follow the commandments of the Lord. And that's still not enough. We need the grace of God. We need the grace of God. And the grace of God comes in that environment, that environment of righteousness.
Yeah, so, like you said, Prophet Malachi, for what we know, was the last prophet that was in Israel. If there were no prophets, then that means that God stopped visiting his people because of their sin. Mm-hmm. And this, between Malachi and John the Baptist, it's probably the greatest time frame of barrenness. 400 years prior to that, we had the fathers and we had prophets. This time, 400 years of barrenness. But God, after, every time when there's barrenness, God brings plentitude of fruits. And this is what we're going to see. We see not only John the Baptist, but then Jesus is going to follow. So Elizabeth is barren, and this is nothing new in the Bible. Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, Hannah, they were all barren, and God blessed them all. It was divine intervention time after time.
Mm-hmm. there, those events, like you see with Abraham and Sarah, and they're both advanced in years, though that is a foreshadowing, a type for John, because in this, it's a very similar situation. You have Abraham, Sarah, both advanced in years, and yet the Lord comes and visits them. Okay, comes and visits, or rather says angels came and visited them. You know, as a, you know, that's the terminology used in Genesis, angels. And they said, you will bear a son. And they conceive, at that moment they conceive, in advanced in years, Sarah conceives Isaac. And you see here again, angel coming, and John is conceived. We see also a perfect parallel, parallel here is also with Samuel, because Hannah is also, the mother of Samuel, is also barren for, you know, for years, and she cried to the Lord. She's suffering a lot because others speak of her. And you can see here, you can take away from the later verses that Elizabeth also probably feels shame because barrenness was looked at as cursed by God. You know, what does she do? Why is God cursing her with no children? Even today in many cultures, they see that as a curse. God is cursing you. That's why you don't have children. So Elizabeth feels that pain and suffering just like Hannah did in the Old Testament. And Hannah goes and says to the Lord and prays for a son. And it says, if you give me a son, I will offer him up to the Lord. And what happens? Hannah conceives a child. And through it's prophesied through Eli, again, in the temple, in the place of worship, in the tabernacle. Eli prophesies to Hannah that her prayer will be answered. And Hannah conceives a child, Samuel. And Samuel becomes a prophet, then the last judge of Israel. And what does he do? Samuel anoints King David, pours the oil on him, and anoints him to be king of Israel. And what happens to John? Now that foreshadows John, because John, also a prophet for the service of God, goes, and what does he do? He baptizes Jesus. And what happens right after his baptism? The Father anoints Jesus with the Holy Spirit and says, behold my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. So you see that Samuel introduces David onto the scene, and John introduces Jesus, who is the fulfillment of the Davidic kingdom, of the Davidic kingship. So he is the new David that fulfills and takes the throne of his father David.
Amen.
I think it's powerful to also see that, you know, Ambrose talks about this too, that we shouldn't be surprised that angels are being emulated when Christ is present. You know, like the message of God, you know, the message of God, to being able to send out the message. Because I think sometimes people are kind of wondering, you know, what's the purpose and why this and why that and why is the angel appearing here and that. But it's important to kind of recognize the importance of how God is bestowing upon this message, that it is so important. John the Baptist is important. Jesus, of course, is important. But, that the angels are here to present this because this is needed to be heard and listened to and understood.
So either when the angels visit people or prophets come, that's a sign for people that God is visiting his people. You know, it's always a sign. So if we say angel announced, that means God is announced. Because angel, word angelos in Greek, means the messenger. He brings the messages of God to his people. So let's continue to verse 8 through 10. Now while he was serving as a priest before God, when his division was under the... according to custom of the priesthood, it fell to him by lot to enter the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And the whole multitude of the people were praying outside at the hour of incense. So we see now here, we talk a little bit about the 24 priestly divisions. And at this time, it falls to Zechariah. He belongs to the priestly division, which is a eighth division of Abia, and he is there to dedicate his time. He leaves his house. It's very important because we will see that even priests at the time who served at the temple abstained from their wives, you know, and he's away from his house, and until that time was fulfilled, he just served in a temple, and he did this probably for a long time, and he's burning incense in the temple. So what we have here, angel appears at the right hand of the temple. You know, almost angel is foreshadowing and foretelling what's going to happen, that Jesus will take place at the right hand of the Father and serve as a priest forever. So Zechariah sees him and he's not at ease, you know, and everybody's waiting. So one thing that's kind of interesting is that to enter into this ministry, it says he was drawn by lot to serve. You know, human discernment is not enough. They casted lots. Who's going to serve today?
Yeah, you see this with the same situation with Matthias taking the role, the office that Judas Iscariot abandoned. And just to add to this image of Zechariah entering and offering incense in the temple. This is a liturgical accent, a liturgical event. We know we as Catholics, we especially in our church, there's always incense, you know, and I love it. It's beautiful around the altar. There's incense and smoke, and this liturgical action that's happening, you know, it's tied. And as you're reading this passage, really, it just kind of reminded me of Revelation 2, you know, the incense and the angels right by the altar. It's like it's kind of like, you know, a little bit of copy and pasting maybe that happened into Revelation. Not copy and pasting, but there's a connection here because we can see that in the Old Testament, all this liturgical action, everything in the Old Testament is liturgical. The sacrifice of the temple, the incense, the candles. It's very familiar to what we do in church. And there's a lot of Christians, you know, a lot of Protestant Christians that love the Lord, but they kind of ignore this aspect of liturgy. And this is so important because it doesn't make sense that Christ, that God, commands the Old Testament all these liturgical actions, and you see this liturgical action by Zechariah, and Jesus comes on the scene and says, you know what? The hell with it all. It's not important. We're not going to do anything liturgical anymore. We're going to have rock concerts, and that's how you're going to worship me on Sundays and get together, and hopefully somebody gives a really good speech about me, and that's the end of it. No, that's not. I mean, that's pointless. What's all this whole Old Testament is all liturgy. It's kind of ridiculous for Jesus to come on the scene and say, that means nothing. But we see that what Jesus does is he takes all these things that happened in the Old Testament, all this liturgical action, and now he says those all point to me. And now we're going to do the true liturgy. You're not going to offer calves and bulls as a sacrifice, but you're going to offer me in the Eucharist every day. And incense will be burned every day around my altar, offering me as a sacrifice to God the Father. So it's not that Jesus kind of says, you know what, the hell with this liturgical action, or it only happens in heaven now, it doesn't matter about earth anymore. No, the heavenly liturgy is in earth, and it continues from earth to heaven. It's not that it's wiped away, but rather Jesus elevates it and brings it to completion in himself and in the earthly liturgy that we celebrate every Sunday, every day in the Mass.
So in verse 13 says, but the angel said to him, do not be afraid, Zacharias, for your prayer is heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John. See, right away, in each instance, when angelic figures come to earth, they tell people, do not be afraid, because they're terrified. They're angelic beings. They're power. They're not girls playing in a Christmas play. They have power to destroy the earth. They can shake the foundations of the world. And every time they tell them, do not be afraid. And as I mentioned many times, it's completely different when a legend, Angel Gabriel, came to Muhammad and he choked him and said, recite. And he said, I can. He choked him, recite. He said, I can't read, and kept choking him. He never said, don't be afraid. But we see these angelic figures knows that people cannot bear his presence and says, do not be afraid. And look at the messages given them. So what's happening here? God is generous. When Elizabeth and Zacharias lost the human ability to have a child, God steps in. God can do what people can. This is why we need God. When we cannot do something that's in our human ability, we can do it with grace of God and through ability of God. So all this waiting period, all this time that they waited for just a child. Yet God gives them a prophet. Not just a prophet, but greatest man. Jesus says, greatest man born of a woman. Look at this. This is all God's doing. Yes, they were righteous, but God acts and gives them a prophet. Someone great, because they prayed continually for the child and God blessed them, but God through it also fulfilled his own mission to bring the prophet to announce the coming of his son, Jesus Christ.
Yeah, and just to tie kind of the last few verses with this final verse of fulfillment, we see that Zechariah, he has this miraculous vision of the angel because he's disposed himself. Where is he at? He's doing a liturgical act. He's in the temple. People outside are praying. And he receives the graces of God to bear a son. This is something that we have to see that in our lives, when we want God, I think people oftentimes they search for God. They say, where is God? You know, and they're searching for God, but they're not searching for God. They don't predispose themselves to receive God. So you see Zechariah, where is he at? He's in church. He's doing a liturgical act. And the people outside are praying. He's been praying himself. He's prepared to do this mission for the Lord, to burn incense. In our lives, when we want to communicate to God, or God wants to reveal something to us, we want our prayers answered. We have to dispose ourselves spiritually to God. We have to, you know what I mean? Like, we have to put ourselves where God can speak. You know, you mentioned earlier that this didn't happen in a festival. It didn't happen in a bar. It didn't happen when they're drinking. It didn't happen when they're in the field. Because your noise, there's too much noise. You can't hear God. It's not, when God wants to speak to you, you got to put yourself in a spot where you're with the Lord. You've cleared out all other things, and it's just, Zechariah is in there alone. You know, they used to tie ropes around the priest that went into the Holy of Holies to offer incense because no one else entered there. It was private. In case the guy had a heart attack or something, they could drag out his body so no one would enter the Holy of Holies. It was so holy. So you see that Zechariah is in there alone before the Lord, and he has this miraculous vision. And ourselves too, in our prayer life, we have to put ourselves alone with the Lord so that the Lord can speak to us. If we want our prayers answered, we gotta give Jesus the time of day. If we don't give Jesus the time of day and we say, yeah, the Lord has answered my prayer, have you really prayed to the Lord? Have you sat down before the Lord and said, Lord, I desire this? And have you waited for the Lord? Because the Lord sometimes, they waited to have a child, but the Lord, like you said, we gave him a prophet instead. The Lord sometimes makes you wait for his gifts. He wants to expand your heart. He's not a genie just to make your wishes come true. He wants to expand your heart to receive the gift that he desires to give to you, which is always, almost always better than what we ever wanted.
Imagine just the way, like when you said the word disposition, you know, and for myself, you know, speaking for myself, when you dispose yourself and you're living a life of sin or in darkness or angry and you go to pray, you cannot hear anything like you're talking about. Just like in that disposition of where my mind is, like, you know, we've talked about this many times before when we try to dispose ourselves, you know, out of pain or anything, you're taking pills or drugs, you know, to kind of alleviate this. But imagine our soul, and when we're trying to to disposition ourselves to hear God, but we have so much sin that the only way to be healed from that is from God and his grace. So being able to try to find that disposition to kind of get yourself, this is why, you know, the temple and the church are so important, you know, in this liturgical act, is to allow those who are in sin to lead them towards God so they'll be able to disposition themselves to hear him better.
On verse 14 and 15, we have, it says, and you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. So John, Zechariah will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at the birth of John. For he will be great before the Lord, and shall drink no wine or strong drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. So, what's going on in here? Birth of a holy man, it's a joy for his parents, but it's a joy and gladness for all other people. Because birth of a holy man, like we said before, brings the presence of God. Holiness is of God. And when we have a holy person in our midst, that means we have the presence of God through the holy person. And then it says, he will be great and many will rejoice. What's the greatness of John? Which empire did he build? Which empire did he conquer? What did he do? What did John do that made him great? He served the Lord. So you see, in the eyes of God, to be great is to serve the King of Kings. Not to be a king on your own and conquer empires and build the greatest empire, but to serve the King of Kings, to whom all empires and everything else belongs.
And we see this also as well, this kind of prophetic image of John, that he shall drink no wine nor strong drink. Later on it says that the razor will not touch his face. All these images, this has been foreshadowed in the Old Testament, rather, through many of the prophets of old. For example, Samson. Samson was also
a Nazarene,
and he had these traits. And we have this image of John, that he's not there to party. You know what I mean? He's not there to party. He's there to serve the Lord. You know what I mean? And this image of him being filled with the Holy Spirit from his mother's womb foreshadows later on when she conceives John and Mary visits Elizabeth, and John leaps in Mary's womb, and it says that she was filled with the Holy Spirit. John was filled with the Holy Spirit in Elizabeth's womb. That consecration to the Lord, you know, to be destined for the Lord. That in a way, you know, when all my children were born, before they were born, I'd always prayed on Susie's. I laid my hand on Susie's stomach, and I prayed, Lord, I consecrate this child to you from the womb. You know, it's a very powerful image to be consecrated to the Lord, like John was consecrated from the very moment of his conception to, you know, throughout his entire life to the Lord. It also foreshadows Jesus, who from the womb is consecrated to the Lord. Clearly, he doesn't have an earthly father. He has a divine father.
So imagine this. In Jeremiah, it says, before I formed you in your mother's womb, I knew you. Mm-hmm. Before you were born, I consecrated you.
Yeah.
This is fulfilled in John. But this just made me think. John is filled with the Holy Spirit since his mother's womb. Imagine aborting a child like that.
Yeah.
It just really like spoke to me, like, mm-hmm. Imagine how many abortions happen, and some of these kids, some of them are probably filled with the Holy Spirit, you know, and of parents who at one point were baptized and experienced the seal of God upon themselves, but rejected him and ended up, instead of bringing the prophet into the world so they can rejoice and the world can rejoice, they ended up killing their child, and no one rejoices. It causes pain to the person who does it and pain to the community.
It's interesting when you say that too, because you hear the angel come to Zechariah and he's giving him reasons to be joyful. You know, he's preparing him, because oftentimes, like you said, you know, you're going to have those parents who are in doubt and in fear, whether they're advanced in age or not old enough, or they're scared, or all these type of things that might, you know, the devil is wishing to tempt to put upon the parent to give these reasons of doubt. Just because when you mentioned that kind of, you know, kind of drew to my attention, because you see the angel says, you know, hey, rejoice at his birth. You know, we should be rejoicing at every birth, because this is a gift.
Even my eighth child.
Even your eighth child, my fifth, you know, Danny's third, or all these type of things that are kind of going around.
That also spoke to me too, because I'm like, who was it? Jacob rejoiced at the birth of his 12th son. You know, he loved Benjamin. And I'm like, when my wife announces new pregnancy every year, I'm like, again? You know, and really God spoke to me. It's like, just rejoice, you know?
Yeah, advanced in years.
And this passage also leads credence to the Catholic practice of baptizing infants, because you see that John, from his mother's womb, is filled with the Holy Spirit. He doesn't have an intellect. He doesn't have reason and knowledge and all these things that we have as adults. He's a baby. He's not even a fully formed baby. He's a clump of cells, right? He's an embryo in the early stages of life. Yet from there he's filled with the Holy Spirit. How much more a child that a parent holds in his hands and consecrate, living before the Lord and pouring water in his head and consecrating to the Lord through baptism. I mean, if John from the womb as a microscopic cell can be filled with the Holy Spirit, how much more even, you know, a child in baptism can be filled with the Holy Spirit. And what is John known for? John is known as the John the Baptist. He's the one who baptizes. That clear link of
foreshadowing. And people always would come back and say, yeah, but John was filled with the Holy Spirit because when Mary went to Elizabeth, presence of Jesus was there. And we tell people, yeah, come to any Catholic church, real presence of Jesus, substantial presence of Jesus is in the sacrament, yeah. In the sacrament, in the Eucharist. So let's go to verses 16 and 17. It says, and he will turn many of the sons of Israel to the Lord their God. I hope, you know, these prophecies can turn my children to me and never depart from me. And he will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah. So see, all of this is about Jesus. It's not about John. It's not about Zechariah. It's not about his righteousness. It's not about Elizabeth. Technically, it's not even about John. All of this leads to Jesus. He's paving the way to Jesus. It says, he will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn hearts of the fathers to their children. So you see, to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children too, because children can lose heart for their fathers and fathers can lose heart for their children. But when the grace of God comes, everything it's put in order. So this is something that any child would desire to have someone like this do this in the family. And every father would desire to have someone who can turn their children to him, and every child would desire to have someone turn their father to them. And this is only done when God intervenes. You know, when many people complain about kids and or kids about fathers, I just tell them, pray, let God intervene, because only then will family be exactly what it's made to be.
Amen. Yeah, and we see the spirit that lies upon John, the spirit that he will have, is the same spirit that was upon Elijah, which is the Holy Spirit. And Elijah was a prophet of the Lord who announced, you know, who announced the people of Israel. And in the same way, John will be a prophet of the Lord who announces to Israel. And, you know, you see like a lot of parallelism between Elijah and with John. The one that comes to mind, you know, that I feel most importantly is, you know, Elijah splits the Jordan River, you know, just like how in the Passover, when Israel left Egypt out of slavery, they crossed the Red Sea, and the crossing of the Red Sea foreshadows baptism, right? The crossing from the slavery of sin through the waters to freedom. You see this with Elijah too. The, you know, he splits the Jordan River, also foreshadowing baptism. And what is John known for? What does John do in the Jordan River? He baptizes. And who does he baptize in the Jordan River? Jesus. And this clear,
you can almost say he split heavens.
Exactly.
Because right after that, the heavens, the voice from heaven comes, and Holy Spirit comes, and Father says, this is my son.
Yeah. You see that power, you know, that spirit of Elijah, it was like pointing to that event, that splitting of the Red Sea. It happens in the baptism of Jesus, that splitting of the heavens and the outpouring of grace.
And you see another thing, Elijah didn't want to serve King Ahab, and John the Baptist didn't want to serve Herod. You know, tell Herod, okay, whatever you're doing, it's fine. Mm-hmm. He says, no, what you're doing, it's not fine. He had zeal and power in the same way, and they both spent, because of it, they both spent a lot of time in the desert. So a lot of parallelism between them two, because yes, that's why he comes in his spirit, because he's fearless and he can speak to the ruler's face, because he belongs to the great ruler, God the Almighty.
And one of the most key things that you see from Elijah is he would preach repentance, restore the tribes of Israel. And these are the things that he's preparing. And you see John kind of going out throughout everywhere. His main mission was to prepare the way of the Lord. And that's kind of what Elijah was doing, as he preached repentance and the restoration of the tribes of Israel, which we see, then we'll kind of get into a little bit further.
Yeah, and just to, you know, that connection, because how does Elijah, the uniting of the tribes, and how does that happen? How does the uniting of the tribes happen? How is that fulfilled? Through baptism in Jesus Christ. He unites all the tribes of Israel by baptizing all the nations of the world, and all those lost tribes are united back together with the Lord. So that power of the Holy Spirit.
And especially with the tribes of Israel, you're going to see how does Jesus commission that? By, you know, telling his 12 apostles to go out and preach and baptize all nations. So you see the tribes of Israel being restored in the prefigurement of the church through the 12 apostles and the 12 tribes.
Amen. So let's go through verses 18 to 20. And Zechariah said to the angel, "How shall I know this? There's doubt there. For I am old man," he's dependent on himself, "and my wife is advanced in years." Everything he's saying is true. And the angel answered him, "I am Gabriel, who stand in the presence of God, and I was sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news." Evangelion, to bring the good news. He's bringing them the message. And what is happening here? You see, all this time, we spoke about righteousness of Zechariah. That meant nothing when supernatural power is at hand, when angel comes and proposes something that goes above human abilities. He's quick to do what? To doubt. He says, "How can this happen?" And it almost seems like a little harsh. Like, why is angel rebuking him? Man just asked, "How can this be?" He's doubting. It's normal to doubt, but it's normal to doubt to different degrees, because Zechariah is a priest and he serves God at the altar, and probably he had Torah memorized. He knows in a salvation history what happened in Old Testament, that Abraham was in advanced years and Sarah was barren, and God destroyed her barrenness and filled her with a gift, and she brought to Isaac to life. So imagine even if Zechariah read that day or days prior, and now he says, "How can that be?" And angel's like, "What do you mean, how can that be? You know this happened over and over and over. You actually probably taught people about this." You know, many times we preach to others about certain things. When it comes to us, we don't believe that it can happen to us. You know, so this is why he is rebuked.
Yeah, and apparently, because Mary later on says kind of the same thing to the angel Gabriel when she goes to introduce Jesus into the scene. But the difference between that is that also, number one, Mary is, there's no precedence for that. Like, she's a
virgin. Never happened before.
That never happened. Jesus is a unique event in all of salvation history, the only and ever will be, you know, that virgin conception. So that's a unique event where there is precedent for John's conception. This happened through many times in the Old Testament, you know, particularly with Abraham and Sarah, whom, you know, through that event, Zechariah came to be, because Zechariah is a descendant of Abraham. Like, that's an important event. Like, I wouldn't exist if Isaac wasn't conceived. And also to parallel between Mary, you see that Mary asked this to the angel, and the angel responds to Mary, because Mary has an authority there. You know, she's queen of the angels. When we pray the litany to Mary, she's referred to as queen of the angels. And there's like this authority here where the
angel tells her, "Hail!"
Yeah, you know, exactly. Like, you know, you say that to kings. It's it's a greeting of authority. It's a greeting of respect, where, you know, Zechariah is below the angel in the hierarchy, and because there's hierarchies clearly in the angels and in salvation history and people. You know, Mary is above the angels and Zechariah is below the angels.
So we have this verse. It says, "Behold, you will be silent," verse 20, "and unable to speak until the day that these things come to pass, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their time." So what's happening here? When you disbelieve, you're silent. Sometimes when you wonder, like, why is that priest or bishop or not standing up or preaching? Probably is in disbelief.
Yeah.
Prophets shout from the rooftops. John the Baptist shouts from the mountaintops, from desert, anywhere. He's crying, "Prepare the ways of the Lord." When you have a doubt in your heart, you cannot shout. You are silent.
And you see this kind of aspect too, because, you know, the angel knows everything about Zechariah, right? He knows he's old, he knows he doesn't have a child, he knows his wife, he knows everything that kind of displays this information about you know, about Zechariah, and he goes, you know, and he's silent because of, you know, disbelief. And he also has the authority, the angel also has the authority to mute him, right? And the difference where we kind of see with the Blessed Mother, where the angel kind of comes and, you know, and then answers differently, hail, right? He doesn't come to say, Zechariah, hail Zechariah, right? You know, and as we see these parallels between the two of them, you can kind of see the difference between the greeting between the angel and the Blessed Mother, and you see the angel and Zechariah, and you also see the differences that are displayed.
Verse 21 through 23, and the people were waiting for Zechariah, and they wondered at his delay in the temple. And when they came out, he could not speak to them, and they perceived that he had seen a vision in the temple. And he made signs to them and remained dumb. He still couldn't speak. So you see, people are waiting for him. Also, this spoke to me kind of in a liturgical way. At the time when this incense was presented on a daily basis, people waited, whoever came and approached the temple, waited for the blessing. Exactly how we wait for Mass. Sometimes we wait for the priest, just give us the blessing. If the announcements are too long, we still wait, and there's sometimes like, dude, just give us a blessing so we can leave. See, people are waiting there, and they're waiting and waiting, but this time it wasn't announcements. Zechariah had a real conversation with an angel, and when he came out, he spoke with sign language. And as the fathers of the church, they read in the Catena Aurea, compared this, and they said, this is speaking with sign, it's a dying person. When you are in disbelief, you are dying inside. And a dying person speaks how? By signs. Give me water. Cannot say give me water. Points, speaks by signs. And this is what fathers of the church said about Zechariah. Now that he's in disbelief, he is spiritually dead. And he speaks with signs, no longer shouts on joy to announce the good news.
Yeah. And just to kind of tie also with the angel, look at the power of the angel. Again, this is very unique because the angel, Mark, you mentioned that the angel knows Zechariah, knows about a barrenness, has all this knowledge of Zechariah that he will conceive, that Elizabeth will conceive, a very intimate knowledge. Because why? What does it say? He says in verse 19, I am Gabriel who stands in the presence of God, and I was sent to speak to you. Gabriel is in the presence of God. What does Gabriel not know in the presence of God? Like, sometimes people wonder, do the saints know about us? Do the saints know what we're going through? The angels and saints, how could they not know? They're looking at God in the face. How could those who have gone before us in faith not, as Jesus? They're looking at the Trinity face to face. Of course, they have knowledge. All the knowledge is available to them because, if you don't have knowledge in heaven, when will you ever have knowledge? You know, God, all the veils are off. So the angel knows this. And look at the angel. He has the power. Gabriel has the power out of spontaneously to mute Zechariah out of nowhere. Just boom. You can't talk anymore. For 9 months.
Michael rebuked Satan too.
Exactly. Yeah. And it's like you see these angels.
He said, may God rebuke you.
Yeah. And of course, the angel knows this through Jesus. And the angel has this power to mute Zechariah by God. But you see, if the angel of God can curse Zechariah for his unbelief, how much more can the angels, saints of God, who are good and are worshiping God day and night, how much more can they bless? If the angel can mute Zechariah, how much more can the angels and saints make the mute man speak, you know? This is where we get the intercession of the saints, intercession of the angels in heaven, that they can act on our behalf. It's a pious Catholic tradition to pray to the saints, to ask them for help, because they can do stuff. Look at Gabriel, mutes him. Why couldn't Gabriel not do the opposite, which is more good, more holy before the sight of God, to do something that is, you know, not to curse, but to bless? So we see this intimate connection here. And just to bring it to another, you know, full around what you were saying, Louis, about that deafness, the inability to speak. I mean, I can testify personally that when I'm in sin, my voice is not loud. You know what I mean? There's like the zeal is not there, you know. And
Jesus is Lord. You're great. Jesus is Lord.
Yeah. And you see this pattern in the church with bishops. You see with priests, even with laity, with politicians, boom, their mouth, they're muted. It's almost like, and now they're muted because of lack of belief, but it's almost like God is also cursing them for the lack of belief. Like it's, they're getting what, the church is getting what it kind of deserves. You know what I mean? Because we've, as a people, have lost belief. And what does God do? He mutes the priests. He mutes them because of their unbelief and the unbelief of the people.
To get a little bit, you know, you as you see this too, you see this in the presence of when the angel speaks to Zechariah and he's muted, and we'll see a little bit later, when the angel speaks to the Blessed Mother, we get two different canticles, right? You get the canticle of Mary right after, right? And she goes out and says, and preaches this beautiful prayer. Zechariah comes out of the temple, muted. Right, and this is the difference between. But when
then he's unmuted, then he gives a canticle.
Then he gives a canticle when he comes. Exactly. So when this is the presence of the healing, the ministry of the church, because you know, as we see, the Blessed Mother is the mother of the church, and what we get presented today when we are blessed by God.
Just one more point to touch. People can say, "Well, it's normal for Zacharias to have doubts. It is normal to have doubts, but listen, it's not normal that Archangel Gabriel." comes to you and gives you the news.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
because people can really say, like, why is he mad? It's not easy to believe that. I mean, imagine, you know, like your 90-year-old, 70, whatever. I don't want her to be mad. 70-year-old grandma receives a message she will have a child. She can doubt. It's normal to doubt and it's normal to question, but not when angel who beholds the face of God comes to deliver a news to you.
Whose first reaction is to be afraid. Like you're there trembling in fear, and he tells you this, like, nah. Like, what happened to the fear that you just had?
I know, exactly. Yeah, so let's conclude the verses 24 and 25. After these days, his wife Elizabeth conceived, and for 5 months she hid herself, saying, thus the Lord has done to me in the days when he looked on me to take away my reproach among men. So, like we said, even our, we're Albanian, and our Albanian culture, even if it was a fault of a man, it was always woman that was blamed for not being able to bring a child to the world, to conceive, even if it was not her fault. Could be barrenness of a man. So, Elizabeth was reproached. They were without reproach in the beginning. You know, it says they were without reproach, but they were reproached by man. They were made fun of probably. They thought God cursed them. Now God takes even that. I love in Psalm 23 when he says, in front of my enemies, you anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. This is what happens. Those who wait for God, blessings will happen. And those who reproach them and make fun of them one day will realize that God was on their side. And sometimes, personally, I've seen it happen in my life. When I turned to the Lord and many people said, man just gave away his life. He lost his life. He stopped going to clubs. He doesn't do this and that. But true blessing came, and now they no longer say he threw away his life because they see blessings of God that was open to children, had family, continued all of this. So sometimes we turn away just before the gift comes. Imagine if these people turn away from God and Zechariah didn't go continue offering incense and praying to God, the blessing will not come. But like you said, when we wait for the Lord, our heart expands. And when the heart expands, Lord is able then to put a large gift in our heart. He cannot put a large gift into a small heart. He needs to expand the heart for a large gift. He expanded their hearts for a large gift to give them a son like John the Baptist. And so this is how we're going to conclude tonight, to ask people to open your hearts to the Lord and pray for us that our hearts enlarge and that we may be able to do more works of faith and to show the power of the Lord in our lives. So pray to God and accept for the expansion of a heart, but then ask the Lord to fill your heart with his love and with his mercy and with his grace.
Yes. And in these last two verses, you see this power that Elizabeth receives, this hiding. I was kind of meditating on this verse, you know, on a spiritual sense, the hiding of Elizabeth for 5 months, that when the Lord gives to us that gift, and particularly the gift of faith and grace in our heart, sometimes we need to take, not oftentimes, we don't go out and just reveal the greatest gifts and missions the Lord gives to us. They need to grow first. You know, you just look at somebody who's coming to faith for the first time. Sometimes you need to nurture your faith. You need to hide away. And what is Elizabeth doing in there in this time period? I can only assume she's marveling and like just diving into the mystery that in her old age the Lord has conceived in her a child through with Zechariah. I mean, that mystery and that glory, she must be, you know, completely overwhelmed and just submitting herself to the Lord. I mean, honestly, during those 5 months. But there comes in a point where the gift of God can no longer be hidden. Like Elizabeth, she's old lady. She's hiding away from people for 5 months because she's not showing. You know, first 5 months, women don't really start to show. But eventually, the gift of God, you can't hide it anymore. You can't hide it. She has to reveal the gift the Lord has given to us. And same thing with faith in our hearts. It requires a period of hiding. It requires a period to be nurtured, to glorify, to grow. You know, it's not good for someone who just received the gift of faith, the gift of the Lord, to go right away and just to kind of reveal it. It requires a nurturing, a growth, you know. But eventually, that gift of the Lord, you can't hide anymore. It's like being pregnant. You can't hide. You can hide it for a short time. But when you're pregnant by the Holy Spirit, eventually you start to show, it starts to glow. You have that pregnancy glow. Not that, you know, not that we can get pregnant, but we can, in a way.
You're impregnated by the Holy Spirit.
Exactly. Our heart's impregnated by the Holy Spirit so that we can give birth to Christ in the world. And that's what the church does. And you see this hiding. That's why the Lord, too, the church, hides its most glorious mysteries. The tabernacles are covered. You know, the liturgy was said in Latin for centuries. There's a lot of hiding in the church. There's a lot of hiding because there's a time where the tabernacle is opened, you know, and it's more glorious. You can't always hide it, but the hiding, it builds the anticipation and it kind of points. It points to the mission that it's hiding. You know, that's why Revelation is called Revelation. It's been hidden. Now it's revealed. And when you reveal something that's been hidden, it's more powerful, more special.
Amen. So let's conclude with a short prayer.
Yeah.
To give glory to God.
Amen.
Lord Jesus, we ask you to expand our hearts that we may receive you and enthrone you in our hearts. You are our King. You are our Lord. We accept you in our hearts. And we ask you, Lord, to penetrate into the hearts of all those who listen to this Bible study. And we pray this in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you for watching our content. If you like this video, please subscribe and join the cloud of witnesses. Also, don't forget to check out the recommended videos on the screen and our playlists. God bless you.